Yeah, you gotta love that logo. It's really good. It's about a minute and 45 seconds away from the top of the hour, and that's when Pot Talk with Joe Barton and Paula Gloria will be on TV live from Woodstock. So you gotta be sure to stay tuned and love that. Just a reminder that probably not tomorrow, but probably the next day, and the next day after that, and definitely Thursday night, going into Friday morning, Woodstock 104 will be testing at 104.1 megahertz. So hear the future of public access in Woodstock on 104.1 megahertz. And I guess I can start to remind you that you are watching, wonderful, wonderful you, are watching Woodstock Public Access TV, the digital fiction, Channel 23. On your Time Warner Cable Scumbox, triple play for a triple a ripoff, or channel map enabled digital tuner. Or in digital reality, currently at the behest of the cable company, broadcasting on a whim on channel 20.4 on your digital TV's cable tuna fish, or with or without sound, or picture, or sharpness, depending on where or when you're being tiered. We are streaming live at woodstocktv.org. It is now just a little bit before 11 o'clock, and it's time for Pot Talk with Joe Barton and Paula Gloria.
Three. How you doing out there in Woodstock? It's been a while since we've been back, and we're so happy to be back. I am, at least. I love it up here in Woodstock, and I'm not thrilled with the city. Paula makes me stay there, and she's the boss, so I can't argue with her.
You'll lose She'll more
knock
teeth.
Out more teeth, you know. That's how she is. So I got to behave. Anyway, there's a bunch of stuff that we found out. I'm going to read something right to start this off. This is from the New York Times?
New York Times Sunday section yesterday, which was Joe's birthday, his 68th birthday.
Right.
So it's nice that this came out then.
Yeah, and the politicians, it's finally the media is starting to get in touch with the people. The politicians are still totally out of touch with the people. But this is from the editorial. Actually, Paula reads much better than me, so I'm going to ask Paula to read it. And I'll comment here and there.
Okay, this is from the editorial board of the New York Times. It came out the 27th of July. That's yesterday. It took 13 years for the United States to come to its senses and end prohibition. 13 years in which people kept drinking, otherwise law-abiding citizens became criminals, and crime syndicates arose and flourished. It has been more than 40 years since Congress passed the current ban on marijuana, inflicting great harm on society just to prohibit a substance far less dangerous than alcohol. The federal government should repeal the ban on marijuana.
Let me jump in on that. And that we're really in agreement with. They should repeal this law. It was unconstitutional, and it should have never been. And it's done nothing but harm to the people of the United States.
Okay. We reached that conclusion, and keep in mind, we is the editorial board at the New York Times. We reached that conclusion after a great deal of discussion among the members of the Times editorial board, inspired by a rapidly growing movement among the states to reform marijuana laws. There are no perfect answers to people's legitimate concerns about marijuana use, but neither are there such answers about tobacco or alcohol, and we believe that on every level, health effects, the impact on society, and law and order issues, the balance falls squarely on the side of national legalization. That will put decisions on whether to allow recreational or medicinal production and use where it belongs, at the state level.
That we're in agreement on, too. The states should be able to decide.
But not corporations, though, states.
Right, the states, not the corporate state governments. But at the same time, we're still against they use that term again, legalization. Right. Legalization means you're going to have to get a license, and they'll always have a way to fine you. Or if you don't get a license, or you're extended past, like if the license says you can grow 3 plants and you have 4, they'll still be sending people to jail. Like alcohol prohibition, when they stopped alcohol prohibition, they were still locking up moonshiners. So what happened was they allowed the rich guys to start breweries, and to eliminate the competition, they went after all them old guys who were growing it, who were making moonshine for generation after generation. I'm sorry, but jump back in.
We considered whether it would be best for Washington to hold back while the states continued experimenting with legalizing medicinal uses of marijuana, reducing penalties, or even simply legalizing all use. Nearly 3/4 of the states have done one of these. But that would leave their citizens vulnerable to the whims of whoever happens to be in the White House and chooses to enforce or not enforce the federal law. Do you want to look straight in the camera and say what happened at Shasta County on that with the sheriffs coming in?
Yeah, well, in Shasta County. We showed it on this show, so a lot of you people have seen it. But for those of you who haven't, they gave people licenses for medical marijuana, but up in Shasta County,
California,
the sheriff's department still went out and arrested legal growers using the federal law to go get them. Now, the local sheriff should be going with what the state says and not harassing those people, but the local sheriff is getting funding from the federal government to arrest legal marijuana growers who were growing for medical purposes. So all this legal talk, that's why I'm against legalized marijuana, because that still leaves the government controlling it. If they got to give you a license, you got to have their permission. I'm against them having permission. Before they made this law, any farmer could grow as much marijuana as they wanted. People could grow it in their backyards. Nobody got arrested. Nobody got hassled. Nobody needed a license. So we're for repeal, not legalization. Go ahead, read some more.
Right. The social costs of the marijuana laws are vast. There were 658,000 arrests for marijuana possession in 2012, according to FBI figures, compared with 256,000 for cocaine, heroin, and their derivatives.
That's one-third. Cocaine, heroin was one-third of the people that they arrested, compared to three times that for marijuana arrests. And our government knew from its inception that marijuana is harmless. Go ahead.
Okay. There is honest debate among scientists about the health effects of marijuana, but we believe that the evidence is overwhelming that addiction and dependence are relatively minor problems, especially compared with alcohol and tobacco. Moderate use of marijuana does not appear to pose a risk for otherwise healthy adults. Claims that marijuana is a gateway to more dangerous drugs are as fanciful as the reefer madness images of murder, rape, and suicide. There are legitimate concerns about marijuana on the development of adolescent brains. For that reason, we advocate the prohibition of sales to people under 21. Creating systems for regulating manufacture, sale, and marketing will be complex. But those problems are solvable and would have long been dealt with had we as a nation not clung to the decision to make marijuana production and use a federal crime. However, that paragraph...
Yeah, I want to jump in on that. Here's where I disagree with the media again. They're still behind the times. Creating systems for regulating manufacture, sales, and marketing will be complex. What they're basically leaving it back in the hands of government to regulate it and manufacture it. And people should be left alone to grow their own. And if the local farmer grows peaches, no one regulates how many peaches he could grow. And no one regulates that he can sell his own crop. If a marijuana person grows marijuana, no one should regulate how much they grow. And no one should regulate that whether they can sell their crop or not. See, again, the media has taken, I'll agree, they've taken a big step forward here, but they're still not in touch with the will of the people. Go ahead.
In coming days, we will publish articles by members of the editorial board and supplementary materials that will examine these questions. We invite readers to offer their ideas, and we will report back on their responses, pro and con. We recognize that this Congress is as unlikely to take action on marijuana as it has been on other big issues, but it is long past time to repeal this version of prohibition. On Monday at 4:20 p.m. Eastern Time, Andrew Rosenthal, the editorial page editor, will be taking questions about marijuana legalization at facebook.com New York Times. So that means that this came out on Sunday, and this looks like sort of a PR method to kind of take newspaper readers and push them on to the internet, because at 4:20 p.m., if you logged on to facebook.com Facebook.com/New York Times. They're obviously trying to build up their traffic on Facebook. And what's going to cause a bigger stampede than the marijuana question? I don't know. And you start taking questions at 4:20 p.m.
Yeah. And they didn't give enough time. They put this out on Sunday and then right away on Monday. So they should have given people much more time to be ready for this. We didn't find out about this article until after 4:20, so we didn't have a chance, or I would have been right on it.
It's also interesting that they're complaining that Congress is unlikely to take action. Keep in mind that ever since the Civil War, when the South walked out, there really hasn't been a Congress.
A legitimate Congress.
A legitimate Congress. That's why you have to read very carefully, because due process and equal protection, you know, always exists. And if you understand the law, you can navigate your way through it. Like this thing about regulating manufacture, sale, and marketing. It says what it seems as though it's pushing for is to get rid of the federal crime, but they want it all to go in the state's hands, but it's the incorporated state. And I'm starting to do more research on the definition of New York City according to federal regulations as the United Nations, considering that the five boroughs are in five separate counties. There's a lot of legal implication to that, but that's a topic for another day.
Yeah. And so we're for a repeal of the marijuana laws federally, and we think that all the states should repeal them, but we think that the people should have more say-so. Unfortunately, right now, we don't have governments. None of our states are legal governments like the founding fathers meant when they set up the Constitution. All of them become incorporated, and they're corporations, and a corporation is there for profit. And how are they profiting? They're profiting by picking your pockets every way they can. You know, the taxes are through the roof, and the taxes don't really go. Everybody thinks, oh, I pay my taxes, it fixes the roads. Well, a little bit might go to the roads, but most of it is borrowed, and then they pay it back by raising your taxes. And very few people understand, for many generations, Americans have given money to the government in taxes. Most of the time, the government took that money and they did two things with it. One, a percentage of it they reinvested, and they invested in the Fortune 500 companies, which they own a big percentage of. And if we the people own the government, then we the people own all that money that they have invested that's raised up. If you go to Walter Berrien and the CAPRA account, he'll give you a lot of what I'm talking about. I'm just giving you a quick brief here.
That we can pay our debt 1,000 times over if we could locate the equity.
Right. And, he knows where it is, yeah, and other people know where it is.
I mean by
the people who are tapping into it and stealing it know where it is.
Right.
Just you people out there that are sheep don't know where it is. And what they do is they got two sets of books. They got one set of books that's all in the black. It's all that investment from many generations that they've invested, and they own 60%, believe it or not, the corporate government of the United States owns 60% of Walmart. They own 67% of Time Warner Cable, people. So when you complain about Time Warner Cable and you say, oh, I'll go to the government and complain about them, the government is Time Warner Cable. Same people that are spying on you. So now they got all this money that was made from we the people investing. It's our investments, but they're tapping into it. Now, what they do is they got that set of books, and it's all in the black, and it's all profit. Then they got this other set of books where they say, well, we got to run the government, so we go to the Federal Reserve, we borrow money from the Federal Reserve, which ain't real money, it's just paper they print up, and then they give it to the government to run the government. So they're running the government on debt notes, on toilet paper, basically. Only I wouldn't even wipe my butt with it because it's pretty nasty. But anyway, then they borrow that money from the Federal Reserve. The Federal Reserve charges them interest on the money when our government, if we had a real government, could just print its own money without interest, and it wouldn't cost us anything. But anyway, then they take that debt and they say, okay, now we got to tax the people to pay back the debt for the money we borrowed to run the government for a year. And then every year they do the same thing. And then they
conveniently don't tell you that the debt is to you.
I was going to get there.
Okay, sorry.
She always spoils my punchline.
Go on.
I have your permission?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, see? She's
keep
the boss.
Teeth,
I told you people. Anyway, now they run up the debt by, it's the interest on the money that we keep doing. If the Federal Reserve gives the government $1 million in paper and they want back, say, $1.5 million, well, they only gave them $1 million, so you can't pay back the $5 million, and they know that, and that's part of the scam. So they keep running deeper and running deeper. Then they run the corporate government bankrupt, only the part that's in red, not the part that's in black, because they ain't telling you people about the money, the profit. Walter Berrien said, if the profit that they've made was turned over and used for the people, every person in the United States could be getting a check instead of paying taxes from the government for the next 1,000 years. That's how much money they have in the black. But they keep showing you people out there in television land this fictitious debt that they've created. If the paper ain't worth nothing that they print, and then they say there's interest on that paper, then they never gave money. Money is gold and silver. If you read our Constitution, money is gold and silver, or paper that's backed by gold and silver. Since our paper isn't backed by any of that, what did they back that paper with? They backed that paper with your labor. So,
and faith, full faith and credit.
Full faith and credit in the American people. That's your labor. And that's why you don't own anything, because you were in debt from the time you were born. They did it that way. They also, because we are slaves, our birth certificates made us slaves, they say, well, okay, now we'll give them, we'll make them a corporation. And they created a fictitious you. That's the all capital name that they put on your birth certificate, that's on your driver's license, that's on your Social Security card, that's on your marriage license. That's a fictitious you. They incorporated. Now, they keep that corporation constantly in debt. And what they do is, when your birth certificate was born, it was like a bill of lading. It was two things. It was a bill of lading for you, like you were chattel, or like you just came off the ship, and your cargo. Right? So now your chattel and your birth certificate is a bill of lading for you. It's also, they can't do it, they got to do it both ways. It's also a stock certificate. It's also a certificate in the wealth of America. Right?
Your share.
Your share of the wealth of America. And America's very wealthy, people. Don't let them fool you. Now, what they do is they don't tell you you have wealth. They keep you on the slave side of, there's two points to this birth certificate trick here. They keep you on the slave side. And on the slave side, what they do, when they bring you into court, they bring you in as the all capital person, not the flesh and blood, because they don't have jurisdiction over the flesh and blood, because they're only dealing with corporate law. That's why when you say to the judge, I have constitutional rights, he goes, yeah, right, kiss my butt. That's what he's going to tell you, basically. He won't tell you that. He's not that bold, but that's his attitude. He don't care about you. Say you can say you rights all you want. He just sits up there and says, "Yeah, right. I'm going to rule how I want and fuck you."
Or he'll say, "If you bring up the Constitution one more time in this court, I'm going to contempt of court you." And then, ooh, people.
They have done that to people. They don't do that often, but some judges have done that to people, more on the federal level. But anyway, now, because they, in the old days when we had. When black people were slaves, they owed money. The people who bought them usually got a loan from the bank to own the slave. Now, because they owned the slave and they owed the bank money for that slave, right? They had to take care of that slave. So that meant that they had to feed it and clothe it and put a roof over its head. Or if it got sick and died, then they owed the bank all this money and they didn't have the slave to produce the labor to pay. Well, that's the same thing they've done to all you people out there. Black people ain't slaves anymore. Everybody's slaves now, right? And what they do, since they have to feed the slave and they have to put a roof over its head and they have to take care of it because it's an investment. You out there are an investment.
It securitizes.
Right. They securitize the slave. But they also have to take care of it. So on the day you're born, they put $1,800,000, because of your birth certificate, to take care of you.
Of credit.
It's credit, because we don't have real money. It's not gold or silver. It's just paper. Right? But that credit is what, when you get arrested, they know, the courts, the judges, they know, they tap into that account. You don't even know you have money. You don't even know you have this credit. And every year of your life, because they have to take care of the slave, they got to put $1 million every year, the federal government that puts it up, and so the states can tap into it. Now, if you go down for welfare, they make you think, oh, you should be grateful that the state is giving you this welfare. Well, you know what they're doing? They're tapping into that account. They're giving you peanuts out of your account. While meantime, they're siphoning off big money from your credit account. But the bill is going to you, so they want your labor. So they're keeping you as a labor slave. Now, this is... You're not going to hear this from any of your politicians. You're not going to hear this from the local newspaper, from the Times, right? You're not going to hear this from them. You really got to get yourself educated. And the best place to get yourself educated on this stuff is check out Rod Class. Check out, what was his name? Brune, the
Walter Capra.
Walter Burian, Capra account. Check that out, and you're going to find out that everything that I'm telling you is true. And if you go to Barefoot's World, you'll also find out that a lot of the stuff that I'm telling you, these are people who've done the research. And what was the guy?
Oh, it's CAFRA. CAFRA's Certified Annual Financial Report, just for the sake of those who are searching around it. Felicia did a good job listening, but it's a CAFRA account. Certified Annual Financial Report, C-A-F-A, or R, CAFRA.
Yeah, it's not a P,
That refers to the two sets of books that Joe was talking about.
About the two sets of books that I was talking about. And when you go down to buy a house and you go to the bank to get a mortgage, right? There's millions of dollars in your account, in your credit account, in the CAFRA account. Now, when the bank gets you to sign a paper, the bank takes your signature and goes to the Treasury, to the Treasury. What's his name? Who's head of the Treasury right now?
It used to be Timothy Geithner.
Yeah, I think it's still Timothy Geithner. Okay. They go to Timothy Geithner, who's now the trustee of all your, what is it called again, the account? Trust. You're the beneficiary, right? The credit that they've put in your account is
fiduciary responsibility.
Right. Timothy Geithner has the fiduciary responsibility. He's a trustee of your money, right? So now, when the bank goes with your signature said you went down to take a loan for a house. You thought you were taking a loan. Your signature, the bank takes to Timothy Geithner and says, we have a demand from that trust, from your trust.
From a beneficiary.
From the beneficiary, you. Then Timothy Geithner gives the money to the bank. The bank gives you your money, people. They don't tell you it's yours. What they do is they say, we're loaning you money. Now we're going to charge you interest on that money. But the bank never gave you money.
Now, can you take a break here? Because this is a big... Are you finished now?
Do you have something important to say?
Okay. When Joe was talking about this being a world of fictions, of corporate fictions, a corporate fiction in the all caps name, or even the state being incorporated, so that you say that the people of the state of New York, and you're thinking that's a government, these are actually, and even the people, the players in them, the actors, they're corporate appellees. And the disaster is now what they're doing is they're embezzling from us.
Yes.
Now, a corporation can't sign something. So when the corporate veil falls or you see a hand coming out, is that when you're asked to sign an application, like you're hearing apps, 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 get this app, get that app. What it is you are the one that's generating that application. So you're applying as the beneficiary of a trust to what you're entitled to as a flesh and blood living soul that can generate a signature. That's why there's such desperation for signatures, and that's why the robo-signing was such a violation of due process, because they got flunkies to sit there all day long just signing things. They didn't know what they were signing. They didn't understand. A signature should be coming from a responsible party. So when you go to a bank and you think you're borrowing money, you should have a proper two-party contract where there should be the signature of you agreeing to borrow the money with these terms, and the person who is giving the money, and person I don't mean in legal terms as a corporation, the flesh and blood living soul that can generate another signature is the one that signs and says, I'm giving this to you, and if you don't pay me back, I'm going to seek remedy in court to be made whole.
Right, but they but they never signed it. You people go out and look at all your mortgages and look at the stuff. Look at what your paperwork from the bank. No place in there is there a signature from a bank president saying, I gave this money to this person, because they didn't give you the money. They got it from your trust account. And they have to have this trust account because they have to take care of their slaves. You are worth a lot of money to them. And when they put, one of the reasons that our court systems are filling our prisons with jails of nonviolent people, of people where there was no injured party, in order for someone to really have committed a crime, there has to be someone to say, I've been harmed. But they fake it. They bring you into court and say, the people of the state of New York or the people of the state of whatever have charging you. Well, put these people on a stand and tell me how I harmed these people. They can't. It's all hocus pocus. It's all the shell game. And there's no P under any of the shells, people. It's a scam that they've been running.
And it runs with intimidation, too. And that's the really horrible
right.
part.
And the reason that they do it and put you in jail is because they can tap into that account. Once they... when they charge you with a crime, right? The charge is a fictitious thing. It's You didn't. 90% of these aren't crimes. There's no injured party. So, but when they charge you, what is it? When you go into the store and you buy something and you say, what's my charge? The charge has a money attached to it. You bought 10 cans of peas and they're a dollar a piece, so your charge is $10. When the court puts a charge on you, they already have a set price on it. They might have $20,000 for this charge. Now, when you go in there and you think, well, okay, I'm charged with a crime and I might have to pay a fine, you might pay. They're double dipping here. One, the charge, the minute, that's why whenever you go into court, never sign anything. The minute you sign something, they can tap into that credit account. If you don't sign it, they can't tap into it. And what they trick people in this, they find them guilty and they throw a paper in front of you real quick and say, sign this. You know what I mean? Or you're on probation. Here, sign this. And they trick you and you sign it. The minute you sign it, you've enslaved yourself without realizing it because they really didn't have jurisdiction over you. When you sign that, they now can tap into your trust account. And that's what they're doing. Most people don't know, but every day that someone's in prison, they tap into the trust account for $10,000. And that's why they're keeping our prisons filled, because they're making big money off warehousing slaves. And that's what it's about. They get paid $10,000 a day to warehouse the slaves. And it's time for all you people to wake up and throw the shackles off, say, I'm not a slave, I'm a flesh and blood human being. And you people have been fleecing me long enough.
Oh, do you think that's a call? Wouldn't that be nice to get a call? We're at 845-679-7777. If anybody wants to call, and we can kind of track how people are listening. Yeah, that would be great. Do they want to go on the air?
Yeah, we could take a call.
Okay, great. Caller?
Caller?
You people are scaring the bejeebus out of me.
Okay, we're going to have to say goodbye.
What do I write next to it?
Unless you turn her up so we can hear her.
She's distorted
on the phone. Okay.
Oh.
Okay, first of all, we're...
Hello. Is this better?
Try again.
Sorry.
Try again.
Distorted on the phone. Am I echoing still?
That's better. You're better now.
Okay. Yeah, so Joel, if you could just repeat yourself, what do I write underneath my signature? I reserve my rights.
Well, I can't tell you. Like Paula just said, we don't give legal advice, but I'll tell you what I would do.
Oh,
what
right.
I would do.
Yeah, what
I would write, I reserve all rights and waive none, and I'm signing this under duress. And then put your signature. If they force you to put your signature.
They've never forced us.
You know, but they,
well,
you know,
they knew better.
Pretty much to force you, they got to put a gun to your head. A judge can rant and rave and say, oh, if you don't do that, I'm going to hold you in contempt. Say, well, I'm not signing. And let them hold you in contempt. Now it's been false arrest. See, you got to be willing. I can't say what you should do. I'm willing to take the, you know, okay, I'm not signing. And if you're going to lock me up, then I'm going to sue you, you know, for false arrest. First
right.
of all, you don't have a warrant to arrest me, and you're intimidating me to sign a piece of paper that I refuse to sign. Now it's under threat. Now you're misusing your position as a judge to intimidate me. So that's what I would be saying. You know, first of all, you got to know when you're talking to any of these judges, you're talking to a criminal.
Like where it says your name for your signature, would you write that sentence above your name or below your name or what?
Above your name.
You've got to do the best you can in the moment. But I think the most important thing is to feel that you're moving into an enlightened state, and that enlightened state is a state of who you are and what this circus is going on around you.
Yeah,
how much do you want to be animating this circus, and how much do you want to elevate this whole scene? Because everyone in that room is also a living flesh and blood soul. Today, when the judge told Joe in a store, you want to say that on camera?
Happy birthday, Joe.
What he said on his camera, what he said in the store today was the judge goes, watch my show tonight, you know, because he's running for a seat on the park bench. And this is lighthearted and fun, but it's also deadly serious. And the deadly seriousness of it is that we need free speech. We need, as a community, to be able to exchange knowledge freely so we can alert people to alarming things that they should be aware of, to dangerous things, things like
lawyer,
being
right?
swindled.
So,
and the judge said basically
Please don't interrupt.
What are you going to complain that we did wrong is basically what he said, you know. And I said, well, I'm not really complaining about you right now. I'm running for a seat on the park bench. And he said he would vote for me for a seat on the park bench. But all these judges... See, they know what they're doing. They know it's just a money game.
Hey Joe, happy birthday, and I voted for you today.
Thank you.
But what they don't know is how fast people are going to wake up and how long they're going to consent to this sheep condition. I'm thinking that the original insurance that came along once this federal funding system was put into place was insurance for people who were tapping in or embezzling from these accounts, the insurance of people waking up or not. Because if you wake up that this is what's happening and you're saying, I'm not chattel, I'm not something that can be ripped off, like if you're only a corporation, you don't have rights. But if you are claiming your rights as a living flesh and blood soul, then you say, that's my intellectual property. You can't take that. This is going to be a big struggle for us with Apple, with Google, even with Time Warner, with the Comcast merger. When we say call in to Greg Sutton, we called Greg today, and we called before the show went out the second time at 12 noon, which is the show that you just saw here in Woodstock. And we said to Greg, well, you know, how do you feel about being our official vote counter? And he goes, what have you got me into without my consent? But, you know, he saw the humor about it. And after all, this is a game of ratings. What do the viewers want to see? And how much will the viewers exert themselves to act on what they see? Do you care about being free? Do you care about... Being ripped off. Your attention is ripped off when you're flicking the channels and you're caught on these different ads, or you're mesmerized by the great high def on one show, and here we have to struggle for years on public access and we can't get a high def signal out. I mean, if you, the viewer, want the content, then you'll have patience to stay with the shakier, you know, more, you know...
Screwed with,
you know, a fuzzy image, because you want the content. But there's no reason that we shouldn't be able to come out with sparkling, crisp, high-definition image and really good audio so that you can hear it well, and to have a hookup so that you can call in and we don't have these delays and it's difficult to hear and all of that.
Let me jump in. Except that we're constantly sabotaged by Time Warner, who moves us from one channel to another channel, who does everything. They got commercial channels and they want all the traffic going there. So they're doing everything they can to stifle public access. We need you people out there in television land to start calling Time Warner and saying, my public access station isn't coming in clear. I want it fixed. We need your help out there. We need the viewers to start demanding that the public access... How come my box don't have public access? Because they don't want you to hear the stuff that we're telling you, that Steve Remine's telling you, that Randy and Felicia, that many of the producers down in New York are telling you. That, now,
People long for a community. Even at the VA hospital, I think they had something like Dish 500, and you could see, you know, Fox and all of the channels, but you couldn't get public access. Now, if they're saying that that's basic service, why are the homeless shelters not getting public access? Why is the VA, you know, the Veterans Hospital not getting public access? All these veterans were waiting for their appointment, and I complained. I wanted to get it. We couldn't get it. Finally, I just shut off the television. None of them wanted to watch the stuff that was on. And we had a wonderful, you know, living soul conversation, and we exchanged knowledge. Now, had they been able to watch public access, they would have been interested in knowing what was the pulse beat of the community in real time. And you should be able to have live call-ins. So it's the veteran sitting there waiting for his appointment. He can get on his cell phone and call in.
Do we still have the person on the phone?
Demanded common law jurisdiction.
What was that?
What can you expect them to say? If you went to court and demanded common law jurisdiction, let's say you got a moving violation ticket, right? And you went to court and you said, this violation does not apply to me. I don't consent to this violation because this is a violation of a statute. And under common law jurisdiction, statutes don't apply to me. So what could you expect them to say as a response? How would it go forward once
they're
you stated
trick,
that?
They're going to try to see if you right. really understand that you're not an employee of the corporation that's paying you, and therefore you have to consent to their
and
rules.
And they're a corporate court, and they have corporate jurisdiction, and they keep playing games to try to trick you in under their jurisdiction. So it's really good to study a lot of the Rod Class stuff.
So I just got, what I keep getting, though, when I try to learn this stuff, okay, is I keep getting, like, statements like, this is what I would say if I went to court. But, like, any kind of, like, playing outness, like, you know, how are they going to try to trick me? What can I expect them to say? Because, you know, it's kind of like know your enemy kind of thing. It's one thing, you know what I'm saying, like, to go in there and know what I'm going to say, but, you know, it's kind of like strategic to kind of like have some steps ahead, you know?
You got to be willing to really, well, I can't tell you what to do.
No, I mean, like,
I stand up and fight them.
But
is there any other callers on the line?
We can only take one at a time.
Oh, okay. Could we get you to cut off? Because we want to, if there's someone else wanting to call, we'd like to take in a few other callers. Yeah.
And are they commercial or corporate law? Last, is it a commercial court or a corporate court? Last question.
It's both.
Oh, okay.
It's a corporate court acting under commercial law.
It's a corporation that has shareholders. Shareholders always expect profits. But all corporations should be looked over by the comptroller, who should make sure that it never trumps the rights and it threatens the well-being of the entire community. What happens when you go and you get a mortgage and you think you're borrowing money, because the country is in bankruptcy and receivership, that means that the debt should be discharged right away. In that case, it goes down to the comptroller in Washington, D.C., and I think his name is Frank Vance, and he should discharge the debt. That's what it means when you're in bankruptcy and in receivership. You have trustees overlooking accounts to make sure that the activities of what's concerned can move forward, and whether it's a country or an individual.
Okay, we're going to have to cut you up now, caller, on this particular subject.
She's gone.
Oh, okay. I would like to say, because we've been out of town, there's been a lot of hullabaloo about the library annex that's going up. So many people have, you know, went against it and bitched about it and complained about it. A lot of them didn't know the facts. And the town of Woodstock, Jeremy Wilbur and the town board said originally it was okay for them to build the annex. Then, because the local boys, architects or their cronies didn't get the bid and bitched and moaned because somebody else got the bid, they went against their own agreement. Now they're saying they can only put it in the footprint of the old laundromat. Well, me and Paula are for this this thing that they're building, and they call it stucco. First of all, they're saying it's going to be an ugly stucco thing. It's not going to be stucco, people. It wasn't going to be stucco. It never was going to be stucco, right? So much misinformation has come out about this library annex, and we're personally for it. The young people today, they're all texting. They're all on the computers. They're all got, they got these, what are these new things they call, like a little tiny television screen?
Pads.
The pads. You know, the young people, that annex would be very good for all these young people. It's going to be a computer. There'll be computers in it. It's set up with a nice, if you really look at the plans, there's a nice deck on the bottom. There's room on the roof for people to sit. It's going to be a meeting place for people to get together. It's going to be something really good for the young people. But no, what are they saying? Oh, no, we want it to look like the old run-down houses in Woodstock. All these old shacks that are falling down and should have been repaired long ago.
I've been reading a book called The Fellowship, and it's about Frank Lloyd Wright, and it's thick, and it took me months to get through it. And it talks about, you know, some of the great things he did with falling water and for the Johnson Wax. And what's so interesting is that when you see really extraordinary architecture, it lasts longer even than the corporations. Johnson Wax, you never hear of it anymore. And yet some of these great designs have continued, they've endured, and this is the point of legacy. And what I think is so disturbing to me about the whole library thing is I would like to see a functioning library. I would like to see this issue of broadband addressed, whoever is going to take responsibility for it. I particularly find it very distasteful when the supervisor of the town board or whoever he's representing doesn't like somebody or some type of other energy coming in, and you use property taxes as a weapon. This is something that I think is so unconscionable, so distasteful, that all of the community should start to wake up and understand what property taxes really are. And more people should be responsible to take on the fight that Joe and I started, first with marijuana, then moving to a co-op, fraudulent share scam thing going. And it's going to move on to intellectual, well, the banks, but intellectual property, and also the banks and the IP address discrimination. We need to have homes. We need to have physical places. And when there's so much fighting on it, God knows Frank Lloyd Wright and the Guggenheim and all of that. Yes, there always was this issue of differences of opinion and differences of aesthetics. But like Randy was saying before, the most important thing is not that we agree, but that we have a reliable platform. And upon that platform, we can share our differences of opinion so that together, precisely because we have a different opinion, we can work together to come out with the best possible outcome.
And let me say that I'm of the opinion, and I've watched this from the very beginning, that this is a great thing for Woodstock, and that pettiness and politics is going to spoil something that future generations, the young kids and the people coming up, really should have. And because of discontent by architects who didn't get the bid, and by politics playing all these games, they've called this all kinds of names. They've misquoted a lot of what's going on. You know, oh, it's going to be too big. It's going to be something really good for Woodstock, and I think that you people out there should really take another look at it. And take a look at how your politicians, Jeremy Wilbur originally in the town board, originally said, yeah, you can do it. And then when the cronies and the architects that get normally all the bids in Woodstock started pumping up people and creating all these false rumors or false accusations or false things. Like it's going to be stucco. It was never going to be stucco, people.
Let's move on. Right now, we're going to have a public access studio, you know, immobilized. Who cares whether it's a library, this or that? Who's taking responsibility for the broadband? Why do we have WoodstockTV.org on the internet going out with ads? This is outrageous. Why, when Angela quit, why before she quit did she not teach somebody how to use the carousel? I don't know what's going on with that right now.
It wasn't that she didn't teach somebody.
Well, they don't know
Rich
how to do
Spool
it.
Won't do it.
He knows how to do
he
it.
He knows how to do it. And what's the other
he
guy's
know
name?
How to do
Mendes,
it.
Right? Is that his name? And Mendes could do it, but they don't want to do it. And, you know, they don't want to rewire it. You know, first of all, Rich Spool, get the fuck off the job if you ain't going to do it. And Mendes, you too. You know what I mean? Let some people come in here that are willing to do the job.
And it's an emergency.
Let me finish, please. You are going to let this studio die because you don't want to do what's necessary. If you don't want to do it, get off the job and let somebody else do it.
And meanwhile, at least we have a radio to pick up.
And we're going to go off the air here on Woodstock. Me and Paul are going to go on Randy's radio station. When Randy's up and running, we're going off here because Woodstock public access people get no respect. They get no help. Jeremy Wilbur, don't put the money that he gets from Time Warner into this place. It's falling apart, and everything they're doing is killing this station.
But we're not leaving public access. Same with Manhattan. If Manhattan, MNN sells 34, we're not going to produce anymore for MNN. It's not that we're leaving public access. They left it. They became commercial. And that's the same message we want to say for Woodstock. We want unlimited broadband for the people. It's the people who deserve unlimited broadband. Who do you think the big corporations are going to pay for when they say you can't afford this or that? You don't just have a group of five big corporations making a deal behind the scenes and say paying each other. Who is it going to? It's got to be going to the people. So the people need to stand up. So a vote for Joe Barton and for a seat on the park bench.
Yeah. And this is Joe and Paul saying we love Woodstock. And
absolutely.
Even though we've ranted and raved here, we've been trying to wake you people up. Stop being sheep. Become lions. Stand up for yourselves. Have a good night.
Good night.
And you've been watching Pot Talk with Joe Barton. Tonight, starring Joe Barton. What a change. Tonight, also starring Paula Gloria. They were both here. And be sure to tune in next week at this same time on this same disheveled channel, wherever it is, for more Pot Talk with Joe Barton, which is a Manifestation production.